The next example that we're going to look at is ammonia. And ammonia is similar, but there are some key differences between the CH4. So if we look at NH3, in this case, our central atom is going to be nitrogen. With the nitrogen, there's 5 valence electrons. Hydrogen are the ligands. There's 3 of them. Each will contribute 1 electron to the bonding. This gives us a total of 8 electrons and 4 pairs of electrons. In this case, the number of bonding pairs and lone pairs are not the same. So here we have 3 bonding pairs and 1 lone pair of electrons. From the total number of pairs, this is going to tell us that we have an sp3 hybridization, and our electron domain geometry is going to be a tetrahedron. Our molecular geometry, though, is going to be dictated by that lone pair. And when we put our electron domains around the central atom, we have a nitrogen, and we have to put our 4 domains around that central atom. So we put 3 hydrogens around here, and then we have this lone pair of electrons that we have here. And remember when we talked about this Vesper theory, that the repulsion is going to be greater for a lone pair than it was for all the bonding pairs. So in CH4, we had a perfect tetrahedron. And in that CH4, our perfect tetrahedron had bond angles of 109.5. For ammonia, these bond angles are going to be slightly less than 109.5 degrees, because the lone pair of electrons repels the hydrogens more than another hydrogen would. So that's going to have a consequence on the bond angles, but our molecular geometry is still going to be a trigonal pyramid. And in this particular molecule, since we have this lone pair of electrons, the vectors that are pooling in each of these directions are now not equal. So we're going to see a polar end to this particular molecule. So ammonia is going to be slightly different than CH4 in the fact that even though the electron domain geometry is the same, the molecular geometry is going to be a little bit different. And the molecular geometry is kind of like we're taking a picture of this molecule, and that camera that we use, the lone pairs of electrons are kind of invisible. So what that camera is seeing is it's taking a snapshot, and it's only seeing the nitrogen and the 3 hydrogens, and it's not seeing the lone pair. The lone pair influences the shape, but it does not contribute to the molecular geometry. So let's look at another example, and let's look at water. In water, our central atom is going to be oxygen. The oxygen, as a central atom, is going to contribute electrons, so there are 6 valence electrons. Here are hydrogen, there's 2 of them. Each are going to contribute 1 electron. This gives us a total of 8 electrons and 4 pairs. In this case, the oxygen is bonded to 2 hydrogens, so we're going to have 2 bonding pairs and 2 lone pairs. So in this case, we still have 4 pairs, so our electron domain geometry is still going to be a tetrahedron And the hybridization is going to be sp3, since we have those four pairs. But our molecular geometry is going to be a bent molecule. And when we look at this water molecule, it's going to have the same parent structure that the ammonia and the CH4 did. But when we draw this particular molecule, we have two hydrogens and two lone pairs. So in this case, in a perfect tetrahedron, our bond angle would be 109.5, but in this case, it's going to be slightly less than 109.5 degrees, just like the ammonia was. But there's going to be a strong repulsion here because we have two lone pairs on this oxygen. So our repulsion here is going to be rather strong. So when we look at the bond angles, the bond angle that we observe here for the HOH bond is going to be even less than ammonia. So we can look at these and use this Vesper theory to tell us how these bond angles are going to be influenced by these electron pairs. In this case, since we have both of these electron pairs and we have a bent geometry, our water is going to be polar.